I suspect we've all had the experience when we've walked into a room and everyone is in the middle of a conversation and you kind of struggle to pick up and understand exactly what they've been talking about. Or maybe you've been in the middle of a conversation and someone else walked into the room and that they totally misunderstood what was being said because they didn't hear what was being said from the very beginning. Maybe another situation, have you ever come into church late and only caught the last half of the minister's message? Of course, that can be problematic because if we don't hear the first part of a sermon, we might indeed draw the wrong conclusion. Well, what we're going to do today, in a sense, is we're going to break into the middle of a conversation, but I still hope I'll be able to keep you and it within the context of what was being said and yet still grasp the main point that Jesus is making. I mentioned in yesterday's episode that we're in the last week of the life of the Lord Jesus Christ, and he will spend it in Jerusalem. And during this time, he's going to have a lot of conversations with people, how might I put it, people who are ill-disposed towards him, to put it mildly. These conversations are recorded for us in the scriptures, particularly in Matthew, and most of them we'll see are conversations with the religious leaders of the day. So he arrives in Jerusalem at the weekend, on the Saturday and the Sabbath, and here we are on the Tuesday, and he's in the middle of an encounter with the religious leaders. And it began, for us looking at it a couple of days ago, when he was asked by what authority he was doing the things he was doing. Remember, he'd just gone in and cleared the temple courtyard, and he had also said that he taught and he healed people in that place after he'd done that. And these religious leaders came to him and they wanted to know the authority by which he was doing these things. And in essence, he answered them by telling them that they did it by the same authority that John the Baptist had talked about. And John the Baptist, of course, had previously said that he recognized Jesus. Well, he shouted, "Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world." So John the Baptist definitely knew that Jesus was the Messiah. So in response to that questioning, Jesus tells these guys three parables. And these three parables were designed to answer the question ultimately by what authority he was doing these things. But if you look at these three parables carefully, you discover that something else is going on because he goes beyond just talking about himself and his authority. Yes, he talks to them directly, but he also indirectly talks about them, and thereby he's sort of signally talking to the other people who are gathered around, the greater crowd, the multitude, the people that aren't part and parcel of the actual conversation. And by doing so, he uses this as an opportunity to talk about people in general and about how many people are not properly prepared or not being properly prepared to enter the kingdom of God. So what we've done so far is look at the first and the second parable. And today, in our third day, we're going to break into the middle of this teaching session, as it were, and we're going to catch up on the last part of the conversation, so to speak, which will be done, we would notice, by him using a third parable as an illustration of what he's about to say. And maybe the last part of this conversation represents a climax of what he meant to say throughout this message, and it contains what we really need to hear, because this lesson is the closing section and he's summarizing and pointing out what they really need to learn, and us by nature as well. So with that in mind, listen to me as I read to you from Matthew chapter 22, the first 14 verses, keeping in mind that this is the last and the third of a lengthy session of parabolic teaching, and that Jesus is talking to the religious leaders in Jerusalem, and remember, he's talking to them on the last Tuesday of his life here on earth. And in my Bible, this parable is called the parable of the wedding banquet. Jesus spoke to them in parables again, saying, "The kingdom of heaven is like a king who prepared a wedding banquet for his son. He sent his servants to those who had been invited to the banquet to tell them to come, but they refused to come. Then he sent some more servants and said, 'Tell those who have been invited that I have prepared my dinner. My oxen and fatted calf have been butchered and everything is ready. Come to the wedding banquet.' But they paid no attention and went off, one to his field, another to his business. The rest seized his servants, mistreated them, and killed them. The king was enraged. He sent his army and destroyed those murderers and burned their city. Then he said to his servants, "The wedding banquet is ready, but those I invited did not deserve to come. So go to the street corners and invite to the banquet anyone you can find." So the servants went out into the streets and gathered all the people they could find, the bad as well as the good, and the wedding hall was filled with guests. But when the king came in to see the guests, he noticed a man there who was not wearing wedding clothes. And he asked him, "How did you get in here without wedding clothes, friend?" The man was speechless. Then the king told the attendants, "Tie him hand and foot and throw him outside into the darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. For many are invited, but few are chosen." Now, in one sense, this is a fairly straightforward story, yet there's a lot of nuances to the story, so I'd like to begin suggesting that, first of all, on the overview of this 14 verses, we can break the story into two basic parts. Firstly, there's this whole issue of the guests being invited to the wedding feast and the fact that they don't come. And in the second part of the parable, it has to do with the people, those who eventually do come to the banquet, and how some of them are not appropriately dressed. So let's begin with the wedding feast itself and the invitation. And it begins by telling us that this story, that the kingdom of heaven, is like this thing. It's like a king who arranges a marriage for his son, and he sends his servants to call all those and invites them to the wedding, but the people aren't willing to come. Now, obviously, this is a parable. It says so of itself. And the various people in this parable are symbolic of groups of different types of people. Most agree that the king in this story is simply a symbol of the representation of God the Father, who's going to have a wedding feast, if you like, for his son. So he sends out the servants to invite the people to the wedding banquet. It is also often suggested that the people he sent out, of course, well, they're a symbol of the prophets in the Old Testament, who went out and invited the people into God's future coming kingdom. So in this passage, the banquet, the wedding feast, is a picture of the future kingdom of God. And that's a very helpful picture to hold in our mind. So what happens at the wedding feast? Well, it's obviously a time of celebration. It's a time of great joy. And this is a picture of what the future kingdom of God will be like. We're meant to recognize that and hold that. The Lord will come back and set up his kingdom. And that kingdom will be a time of great celebration. A time of joy when we will celebrate and be glad. So the picture being painted in this parable is that of the Lord throwing a wedding feast, a time of great celebration, a time of joy, and he sends out servants to invite the people to come. Now notice it says at the end of verse 3 that some are not willing to come. And of course the history of Israel was oftentimes wanting of tremendous unwillingness to follow the Lord and to call where he called them. They were a rebellious people. So in this parable, the Lord simply says they were invited, but they weren't willing to come. So we see the king in a way switched to, shall we say, plan B in verse 4. Again, he sent out other servants saying, "Tell those who are invited, see, I have prepared my dinner. My oxen and fatted cattle are killed and are ready. And all things are ready. Come to the wedding." Now, I do need to explain that this is a sort of Middle Eastern custom that's being depicted here. Remember, they didn't have refrigeration, they didn't have telephones, and they couldn't email, obviously. So the way of having a banquet was something like this. They started out a few days before the banquet by sending people out into the neighbourhood to tell everybody that there was going to be this great party in a couple of days so people could plan, and that was the point at which they were invited. At that point, people would then be able to say, "Okay, I can come," so that on the day of the banquet, they would then wait, another invitation would be sent out on the day, and it would go out, and people would go out and say, "Okay, everything is now ready, so now come in and celebrate with us." So in the parable, these guests, as we can see clearly, they've already been invited. They were invited in this story 2 days before. But now things are ready, so they're told that they can now come in to the wedding feast. But look at how they respond in the next verses. But they made light of it, and they went their own ways, one to his own farm, another to his business. And the rest seized his servants, treated them spitefully, and killed them. Now, many suggest, and I think rightly so, that this is a picture of the fact that God invited Israel to come into the kingdom in the era, particularly of the New Testament, but they were unwilling. Remember, after previously invited, now, again, John the Baptist, he came preaching that the kingdom of God is at hand, and Jesus also comes preaching the kingdom of God is at hand as well. So in this parable, we now see the wedding banquet is now in fact ready. Everything is in place. And he sends the servants back out again. And he says, it's all ready. Come in now. And this is the time where what do? They make excuses. They make light of it. Went on their own way, considering only the things of this world, like their farms and their businesses. But some of them, on top of that, they seize the messengers, which some suggest, clearly, this could be a reference to John the Baptist and Jesus himself, and they kill them. In other words, they completely reject what was offered. They not only said no, and they want to be no part of that, but some of them were in such outright opposition that they killed them. Indeed, John the Baptist, we saw, was beheaded, and Jesus, as we will see, is about to be crucified. Please do notice that in this passage there is a definite progression as the invitation proceeds. First of all, they are unwilling. Then they make light of what is offered. And then finally we see they even kill the very messengers of God. The result of this is then seen in the next few verses. And when the king heard about it, he was furious. And he sent out his armies and he destroyed those murderers and burned up their cities. Then he said to his servants, the wedding feast is ready, for those who are invited were not worthy. Now, virtually everyone who comes to this passage see in it a reference to the fact that the Jews of Jesus' day, or to be more exact, the religious leaders of Jesus' day, they wholly rejected Jesus as the Messiah, and as a result of that, they perished along with their city. And that generation, that indeed what has happened to them. Jerusalem was indeed soon destroyed after these events. Almost everybody who reads this sees this as a prophetic reference to the destruction of Jerusalem in AD 70 by the Romans, less than a generation later, less than 40 years later. They rejected the offer to come into the kingdom, and in this passage the kingdom is depicted as the celebration of the wedding feast, but we see the result of their rejection is they were destroyed. So the king, we now see, plan C if you like, he issues new instructions. Therefore, he says, go into the highways and find as many as you can find and invite them to the wedding. So these servants went out into the highways and gathered together all whom they found, both bad and good, and the wedding hall was filled with guests. Now, I've told you this is the last section of a longer passage in which Jesus told three parables. Prior to this, he said the kingdom is going to be taken from you and given to another nation. Do you remember that? And now in this last parable, he's picturing these same events in the form of this story. And in that, the first the people were invited, and then they rejected the offer, and then the invitation goes out to a wider group of people. In fact, it goes out into the highways. It goes outside the city, which is an obvious reference to the other nations, the Gentile nations again. So this wedding feast is clearly a picture of us, anyone, everyone, being called into the kingdom, the call to salvation. Jesus said elsewhere that unless someone is born again, they cannot enter the kingdom of God. So this part of the passage is a picture of simply being invited into the kingdom of God. The king in the story is the one who provided the banquet. But now he's going out into the highways and byways and saying, guys, it's been rejected by those that I went to first. It's now an open invitation, a free banquet. But what I think's fascinating about this is that it is also a picture of not just the kingdom of God, but it is a picture of salvation and draws attention to the fact that salvation is a free gift, a free invitation. The gift of God is eternal life, the key word being gift. But although a gift is received for free by the recipient, that does not mean that someone didn't have to pay for that gift in the first place. And in this case, Jesus paid for it. Jesus paid for it when he died for the sins of the people and rose from the dead. But it's free to us, to any one of us who will receive it. All we have to do is accept and trust in Christ and his death as the payment of sin. And that is what the Bible tells us and how we are forgiven. Now, I said this passage was made up of two parts. There's the wedding feast and the initial call, and it does that by showing the order in which those events happen, as well as illustrating the freeness of the gift of the gospel. But the second part of the passage deals with these wedding garments, and as they say, the plot thickens a little. Let me just remind you and pick up again the story in verse 11. But when the king came to see the guests, he saw a man there who did not have on a wedding garment. So he said to him, "Friend, how did you come in here without a wedding garment?" And he was speechless. Then the king said to his servants, "Bind him hand and foot, take him away, and cast him into outer darkness. There will be a weeping and a gnashing of teeth. For many are called, but few are chosen." So the scene now shifts from the feast itself to a discussion about what it means to be properly addressed for such an occasion. And the first question I'm sure springs to your mind is, who is this inappropriately dressed guest and who does he represent? Now, the vast majority of Bible teachers who approach this say this guest simply represents an unbeliever. And when it says he's not dressed properly, it means he's not clothed with the righteousness of Christ. And because of that, he's cast out of the kingdom. Now, that, I believe, is the true interpretation of this passage here. But I do need to add, I'm not dogmatic about this interpretation, because there is another possible way of looking at it and interpreting that. But although it's a minority view, I respect those people who hold that view. The mainstream view of evangelical Christians would say it represents the unbelievers, but a few think otherwise. And if you hold that other view, or know someone who does, then I would suggest that you don't think that person is absolutely wrong in this or in all things. They maybe have just reached a different conclusion on this matter. But regardless, the key point is here, this guy turns up, he's not wearing the appropriate clothes for the feast. And this is usually interpreted as the wedding garment is a picture of the righteousness of Christ. You see, we are told elsewhere on several times in the New Testament that when we trust in Christ, we're clothed in his righteousness. And this guy, he didn't have on an appropriate wedding garment. The idea of putting on clothes in the New Testament is not only here, but is on several occasions represented as having to do with a believer living a righteous life. So I think it goes beyond just the imputed righteousness of Christ. It also means something about living the type of life that we're called to live post-salvation. In the book of Ephesians and in the book of Colossians as well, and in some other places, the imagery of putting on clothes is used of living a righteous and godly life. For example, in Colossians, Paul writes and says, "Put off your old ways." And the Greek word he uses as "put off" is one that means it describes the taking off of a garment or a coat. So we are told to put off things. We're told to put off, to take off things like wrath and anger and all those type of negative things and sins. And instead of that, to put on mercy and compassion and love and those things which we would ordinarily see and describe as the gifts of the Spirit. So in a symbolic fashion, I believe that what is also being said here is that as you develop a righteous life, as you do what is right, as you do what God calls you to do in your life, you develop Christ-likeness. And by doing that, you are weaving, if you like, a garment that you will one day wear at the marriage supper of the Lamb. But I think we can actually, in fairness, stretch this imagery even further. If we turn and look at the last book of the Bible, in Revelation chapter 19, we have there a picture of the second coming of Jesus Christ. Let me read to you Revelation 19, 7 and 8, which says, "Let us be glad and rejoice and give him glory, for the marriage of the Lamb has come, and his wife has made herself ready for him." That's referring to the believers, the bride of Christ, the church. "And to her it was granted to be arrayed in fine linen, clean and bright, for the fine line is the righteous acts of the saints." So do you see what I suggest is also going on here? We're also going to be clothed in righteousness at the second coming of Christ, clothed by our righteous acts as well as the righteousness of Christ himself. If that's true, and I'm interpreting this correctly, I believe we will stand before God clothed in the righteousness of Christ, absolutely, but also clothed with the righteousness of life because we have lived a righteous life of faith. I see that the way we live our life, and as we live our life, we are being told here that we are constructing, weaving together something that is going to be the wedding garment, the one that we will wear to the marriage supper of the Lamb, the one that is made up of the righteous acts of us as believers, as individuals, and as a community of faith, the true church. And I submit to you that this being appropriately dressed is not only a manifestation of being imputed with the righteousness of Christ and clothed with his righteousness, but is also a reference to the way, as Christians, we have lived our life. So it means that at the marriage supper of the Lamb, when we go home to be with the Lord, so to speak, we're not going to be standing in a court of law, standing before a judge. That's the great white throne judgment that awaits the unbelievers. Instead, we are going to the judgment seat of Christ, where we're going to be called in to the banquet, to the wedding feast, in the palace of the king at the wedding feast. And the garment we wear will consist not only of the imputed righteousness of Christ, but also of the actions that made us suitable to qualify to participate in the king's banquet. So look at what it says the king's response to those who appear not wearing the righteousness of Christ, not having accepted or lived a holy life. He says, "Bind him hand and foot and take him away and cast him into outer darkness, and there will be a weeping and gnashing of teeth." As the gospel writer sees it, as Matthew says, the consequences of this refusal are terrible. Yet at the same time, don't lose sight of the fact, do not forget that this passage we should see overall is a reminder that it is an invitation for us to come to a feast, a joyous wedding. His invitation is one of joy. To think of Christianity as gloomy or depressing or just about a list of rules or stopping doing things or giving up stuff is a false representation of our faith. It is the joy that as Christians that we are invited into the life of God that we will miss out if we refuse that invitation. And that's the big message to take on board here. It reminds us that many are deaf to the invitation of Christ. We see in this story, one of these guys was too busy with his estate, his land, his fields, his farm, whatever it was, and the other was too busy with his businesses. Please note that these guys did not necessarily go off and attend another wild party somewhere else, or go on some trip or some great immoral adventure. What they did was they simply remained focused on the everyday administration of their personal and business lives. And by doing that, they missed out on the opportunity to hear God speak to them and to invite them. It's very easy for people, it's very easy for us to be too busy with the things of the world so that we forget the things of eternity. To be too preoccupied with the things that we see before us that we forget about the great unseen things that are important to us. It's too easy to listen only to the call and the demands of the world and miss the still small voice of the invitation of Christ. But it also reminds us that the appeal of Christ is not just one where you are called to consider how you might avoid being punished, but is it a call to come in, to enjoy, and to see what you will miss if you do not take up God's invite. Those who could not come, well, they were indeed punished. But the real tragedy in this of missing out on the wedding feast. And if we too refuse the invitation of Christ, I would say our greatest pain will not lie in how we suffer, but by being in the realization of the precious things that we have missed. To be in a place for eternity, to know that we are excluded from the precious presence and celebration of what it means to be with God for eternity. God's invitation to us is at the end of the day an invitation of grace. And those who are gathered in this case, from the very highways and the byways, from outside the city, they had no claim on the king, no right of their own to be there. They could never, by any stretch of the imagination, have even expected an invitation to this wedding feast. None of them deserved it. It came to them out of nothing, and some of them graciously embraced it. This final parable is a close continuation and amplification of the previous parable. This parable of the open door tells us of how the Gentiles and the sinners and the ordinary people of the world could too be gathered in, not just the narrow nation of Israel. The parable, of course, strikes the necessary balance in teaching that it is true the door is open to all people, but when they come in, they must bring with them a life fit to seek the love of God which has been shown and given to them. You see, grace is not only a gift, it's a responsibility. Any individual who has seen and recognized that call in their life cannot go on living the exact same type of life that they lived before they met Christ Jesus. They must be clothed, in a sense, in this new purity. That's the picture being shown here. Clothed in a new holiness and a new sense of goodness. The door is indeed open for us, for everyone, but the door is not open for the person who comes and wants to remain an unrepentant sinner, wants to remain unchanged and living exactly the same way and in the same state in the world. For the sinner to truly come, they have to accept their need to leave the life of sin behind, the life of godlessness behind. And by doing so, they not only come in, they become a saint. This is the permanent lesson. The way in which any of us come to the Lord demonstrates that we must come before him in and by the right spirit. This closing part of the parable has nothing to do with the actual physical clothes we wear, but it has everything to do with the spirit in which we are prepared to go before the Lord. You see, there are garments of the body, but it is the garment of the mind that's been talked about here. The garment of faith, the garment of reverence. These are the only garments which we ought to be aware of or be wearing when we come to approach God. And too often, too many people go before the Lord without any preparation at all. No thought as to what's wrong in their life. No attempt to change what's wrong in their life. No attempt to seek forgiveness for what's wrong in their life. If only every man and woman came before the Lord prepared to worship, prepared to repent, prepared to pray, prepared by prayer and by a life of service, prepared ultimately by a willingness to self-examination, then worship of the Lord would truly be worship indeed, not only in what we think and say, but what we actually do. We would be prepared to worship in a way which means that things could happen in our hearts, things could happen in the life of the church or the community of faith that we exist within, and that I believe that things can actually happen in the affairs of the world. Because living the holy life means we do not wrestle against people, but against powers and principalities, and thereby, by coming to God and approaching him in the right way, we can be empowered by the Spirit and the power of God to change the very lives of people around us and the world in which we live. Okay, friends, we're today covering quite a long passage of scriptures which will naturally fall into three or four parts for us. And we're going to look at this passage in Matthew chapter 22, verses 15 to 46, where we see Jesus confronted by the various religious leaders of his day and the questions that they ask him and his responses to them. Now, just before I'd say that, I had a conversation with my daughter the other day. She's a college lecturer, and we get together all the time, and we talk about all kinds of things. But one day, quite recently, we got around to talking about and discussing the kinds of questions that people ask. And she said that her and her colleagues were, in fact, talking about this the other day in the staff room, and that they agreed that the questions they were asked by students basically fell into three different kinds of categories. Number one, a student would ask a question just to gain information, and they agree that that was a perfectly acceptable question. And the second kind of question was a request, if you like, for clarification. They maybe asked that when they thought, they were pretty sure they'd grasped hold of something, but they basically wanted to clarify something to make sure they were on the right track, so to speak. And they agreed that that was also a good and a fair type of question. But they also said that there was a third type of question, a question that they thought was really just designed to show how dumb the teacher was, if you like, or how wrong the teacher was, or more importantly, how clever they thought they were. Well, that's exactly the sort of thing that's happening to Jesus here when he's asked these questions. But for him, it's even worse than that, because they're not only asking questions to try and show how clever they are, they're also asking questions to try and trap him. In fact, trap him so they could kill him. These events are taking place on the Tuesday of the last week on his life on earth, a week that will end for him, for Jesus, on Friday with his death and crucifixion. And during that time, we're going to see he will face an avalanche of questions coming at him from all sorts of different sources. It's almost like everyone, certainly the religious and the civil hierarchies, were coming together and turning against him and ganging up and pretty much firing one question at him right after another. But the motivation and the purpose of all this questioning was not to find out something new, not to clarify something, but to try and catch him out, to entrap him and lead to his execution. Now, what I want to do today is look at some of those questions, because not only the questions, but the answers that Jesus gives can teach us a whole lot of very important things. So we'll turn together in Matthew chapter 22, and I'm going to begin reading for you, beginning at verse 15 to 22. And these verses cover question number one, which is the Pharisees and this group called the Herodians, and they're asking Jesus, is it lawful to pay taxes to Caesar? So let's see what it says. Verse 15. Then the Pharisees went and plotted how they might entangle him in his talk. And they sent him with some of their disciples to the Herodians, saying, Teacher, we know that you are true and teach the way of God in truth, nor do you care about anyone, for you do not regard the person of men. Tell us, therefore, what do you think? Is it lawful to pay taxes to Caesar or not? But Jesus perceived their wickedness. He understood it and said, Why do you test me, you hypocrites? Show me the tax money. So they brought to him a denarius, and he said to them, Whose image, whose inscription is on this? And they said to him, Caesar's. And he said, Render therefore to Caesar the things that are Caesar's, and to God the things that are God's. And when they heard these words, they marveled, and they left him and went on their way. Now, this is the beginning of a rather long passage of scripture where Jesus, we're going to see him questioned by one group of detractors after another. The structure is fairly straightforward. First, he is questioned by the Pharisees and the Herodians here. Secondly, he will be questioned by the Sadducees. And then finally, he is questioned by the scribes and the lawyers of the day. And then at the close of the passage, he actually turns round and questions these people. So let's begin with this first section with what the Pharisees do, and it tells us that they're plotting against him. They're plotting how they might entangle him, and it's interesting that they choose to send him with some of their followers, remember, along to also be questioned by this group of people called the Herodians. Now, this is a very interesting combination of people here. First of all, you may be thinking, well, who are the Herodians? Well, the answer to that is that they were a political group. They felt that Herod, in fact, had right to the political throne of Israel. Now, what's fascinating here is it says that these two groups of people are plotting together, because these two groups, the Pharisees and the Herodians, are normally bitter enemies. The Pharisees resented the Roman domination and occupation of Israel, and that's putting it mildly, and they did certainly not think that Herod was the rightful heir to the throne, because they were in fact waiting for the Messiah to come and kick out the Romans and set up the millennial kingdom. So here we have two groups who would normally and naturally be opposed to one another, these religious Pharisees and these political Herodians, but they choose to join forces on this occasion with the aim of getting rid of Jesus. So they band together with Jesus as their common enemy, so to speak. And ironically, they come to him and say, "We know that you are true and teach the way of God and truth, and you don't care what people think." What nonsense. They're trying to entrap him. These aren't true statements at all. It's just a manipulation. At the heart of it, what they've come to do is to try and entrap Jesus. And they do that by asking the question, "Do you think it's lawful to pay taxes to Caesar?" Now, that really could have created a dilemma for Jesus, because if Jesus said, "No, you should not pay taxes to Caesar," he would immediately have been in trouble with the Romans. And if he said, "You should pay taxes to Caesar," well, then he would be in trouble with the ordinary people, because they hated the taxation of the Romans. But look, what they said when they went to Jesus is they asked, "Is it lawful?" In other words, meaning, is it lawful in the sight of God to pay this tax? So how would Jesus respond to that question? Well, we don't have to wait long to find out, because in the next verse, his replies there, it says Jesus, he understood their wickedness, and he said, "Why do you test me, you hypocrite?" He heard the words, but he recognized and he saw their intention. In other words, he saw their heart. He knew what they were really trying to do was just trip him up. This was not an honest question. It was a loaded question. And Jesus' response is to say, "Show me the money." That was a Tom Cruise movie a few years ago, wasn't it? "Show me the money" was the strap line. Well, he says to them, "Show me the money." And the coin they bring to him is a denarius, which is one that was equivalent to about one day's wages at that time. And then he asks them, he says, "Look at it. Whose image is on it? Whose inscription is on it?" And they reply, "Well, Caesar's, of course." And Jesus then says, "Okay, then render to Caesar the things that are Caesar, and give to God the things that are God." Now, there's a difference here in what they asked and what he said in his reply, and this difference is significant in the difference between the words used. The word they used first when they say, "Should we pay tax to Caesar?" It means to give something, insinuating that should they give something and pay this in the sense like a gift. But the word Jesus replies to uses the word render, which is the Greek word that means to return something, in other words, to give something or pay it back. In other words, Jesus is pointing out the fact that there are two ways of looking at money and taxes and giving in this passage. One is that it can be given as a gift, and the other is that it is a debt that has to be paid. So what Jesus is saying, look, you have a debt. You have an obligation to pay your tax for the services you've been supplied with. So when it's time to do that, pay that tax in the currency that is applicable in that sphere of society. But then he says that there are also things that belong to God, and that you should give those things as a gift and give them back to God as a gift, but make sure you give them as a free will gift. In the first part of what's going on in this passage is the beginning of a discussion, a dialogue, a debate, whatever you want to call it, where Jesus is making one simple point, that being it is not incompatible with serving God to pay civil taxes. That is, to pay to Caesar what Caesar was due in the currency that Caesar had created is not being disloyal or disobedient to God. We all have to pay our taxes, but he then says we also have a debt to God to pay, and that debt we should pay willing. In fact, the payment of that debt should be seen as a gift of thanksgiving for what God has done for us. Now, let me pause before we go any further and make one other suggestion. Did you notice he calls for the coin and he says, look at the coin, whose image is on it? And they, of course, said Caesar. And he says, all right, so that belongs to Caesar. So when you have a debt to Caesar, give it back to him in what belongs to him. But then he talks about something, about paying something back that belongs to God and paying it back to God as a free will offering. And I just want to remind you of the fact that in Genesis, we're told that we're made in the image of God. So if the coin had the image of Caesar on it and it belonged to him, and that's how we pay that debt, I believe that it can also tell us that we, who are made in the image of God, should pay back of ourselves that which is now meant to belong to him anyway. If we're meant to give back to Caesar that which has his image stamped upon it, then also we should give to God of ourselves, because his image should be stamped upon us. In other words, the call is to give of ourselves. So like I said, the first question really comes from the Herodians, the politicians, and it has to do with the political system and the taxation. But the second question is a different one, and we'll see that now from the Sadducees. So question two is from the Sadducees, and they ask questions about the resurrection. So I'll read to you now verses 23 to 33. The same day the Sadducees, those who say there is no resurrection, came to him and asked him, saying, Teacher, Moses said that if a man dies having no children, his brother shall marry his wife and raise his offspring for his brother. Now there were seven brothers. The first died, and he was married, and having no offspring, left his wife to his brother. Likewise the second also died, and a third, even all the way through to the seventh. Last of all, the woman herself died also. The question is, therefore, in the resurrection, whose wife of the seven will she be? For they had all been with her. And Jesus answered and said to them, You are mistaken. You do not know the scriptures nor the power of God. For in the resurrection they will neither be married or given in marriage, but are like the angels of God in heaven. However, concerning the resurrection of the dead, have you not read what was spoken to you by God, saying, I am the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. God is not the God of the dead, but of the living. And when the multitudes heard this, they were astonished at his teaching. Now, this question is deeply rooted in the Old Testament, and the fact that God gave the Jews the land of Israel, and he divides up that land and gives it to the various 12 tribes and to the families within those tribes. And what's going on here is this reference to the custom that was unique to the Old Testament, which said if a man had a wife and they weren't able to bear children and he died, his brother was to marry her so that the family name to be carried on. And it was as simple as that. That's what it says in the Pentateuch. Now, what the Sadducees do here is they take that idea and they carry it, well, to literally absurd lengths. And they say, this man had a wife and he died. And then there were six brothers, and one after another, they each marry her. And one after another, they all die. And then the wife dies. And then they ask, who she going to be with after the resurrection? Now, there's a couple of things you need to know when we look at this. Firstly, is the fact that the Sadducees were the ones who did not believe in the resurrection. It actually tells us that at the start of this section. Unbelievable. These very people who don't believe in the resurrection concoct an extreme and ridiculous question concerning the resurrection. By the way, it's also worth noting the Sadducees were the aristocrats of the day. They were the governing body, so to speak, in Israel. And also, it's very important to notice that they only accepted the Pentateuch, meaning they only believed in the first five books of the Bible as being legitimate. They didn't accept any of what we would today call the Old Testament or the prophets or the history writings, any of that. And furthermore, they also didn't accept additional oral tradition that the Pharisees had added on at the time of Jesus. So their argument was effectively, the Pentateuch doesn't mention the resurrection, therefore there can be no resurrection. So what you have here is the Sadducees, the people who don't accept the resurrection. They find an obscure law in the book of Deuteronomy, and they try to use that to create an extreme illustration to try and trap Jesus. Now, In the question they asked, there are two questions rolled into one. One is, on the surface, it's just asking whose wife she's going to be after the resurrection. But the second, implied within it, has to do with the resurrection itself. But remember, they don't even believe in the resurrection. So what happens now is Jesus takes both of those questions and he answers them by quite simply saying their whole premise is wrong. And it's wrong because they don't know the scriptures or the power of God. And then he says, because in the resurrection, all who have been resurrected will have translated bodies and be like the angels in heaven. His answer is, it's not even relevant whose wife she's going to be, because there is no marriage in heaven. Marriage was effectively given as a gift on earth for men and women to experience a bond of unity during their earthly existence. But its purpose was to give a glimpse, to give an earthly model, an insight, if you wish, onto something even greater than that, a glimpse of the reality of the unity that will exist across all risen humanity in the life to come. But then he deals with the resurrection itself by saying God is not the God of the dead, but of the living right now. Now again, this is a quotation from the book of Exodus, so it's going from the Pentateuch. So he's using one of the books that they accept, he's using their scriptures, and he's saying, look, God said hundreds of years after Abraham, Isaac and Jacob had in fact died, he said, I am the God of Abraham, Isaac and Jacob. So he's saying God is not the God of the dead. He's the God of the living, because those who trust in him have eternal life. The point being in that the three people that he names here are still very much alive in glory. The truth hinges on Jesus' use of the present tense here, quoted directly from the book of Exodus, I am the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, thereby implying that God is revealing hundreds of years later, after they died, that they were still alive. They had eternal life in heaven. And again, we see the Sadducees' response, and it is one literally of silence. And the crowd, it says, are amazed. So he silences the Sadducees, yet he astonishes the crowd. But before we go on to the third question that he's asked here, I'd like to just pause for a second. There's something in this passage that has always been deeply meaningful to me. Something in Jesus that's part of his reply to both these group of people, in the fact that he says the reason that they're not thinking the right way is they do not know the scriptures or the power of God. You know, upon reading this at a very young age, I made the decision that I really needed to know and understand the Bible. In fact, over 50 years later, I think you could say I could reduce my whole life's ministry of one of just trying to get me and to help other people to understand and know the Word of God and thereby know the power of God in their lives. And in the course of answering this question, I think Jesus taught me a very valuable lesson, and I hope it teaches you that same lesson today. And maybe perhaps part of getting to know both the Word of God and the power of God is the fact that you've made the decision to make the study of the Bible part of your daily life with us here today and every day. All right, we've heard from the Herodians, the political party of the day, and we've heard from the Sadducees, those were the aristocrats and the ruling party of the day. But there's one more question, and this time it comes from the lawyers of the day. So the third question is from this group called the scribes, and their question is, which is the greatest commandment? So let me read to you from Matthew 22, 34 to 40. And it says, but when the Pharisees heard that he had silenced the Sadducees, they gathered together. Then one of them, a lawyer, asking him a question, testing him, said, teacher, which is the greatest commandment in the law? Jesus said to him, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment. And the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. Now again, these are not questions asked to gain insight or information. This is disingenuous. These aren't questions asking for clarifications. They're again questions that are just trying to put Jesus in a corner and trip him up. Yet in itself, it's still a fascinating question, because they're not asking what is the greatest of the Ten Commandments, they're actually asking him, what is the greatest of the 600 plus commandments spread across the whole Mosaic law? And some have suggested and go a step further and say what they're really asking is which kind of commandment is the greatest, not actually which one. And that's an interesting way to look at that, because some of the rabbis of that time did categorize the commandments, and they referred to some of the commandments as heavy and some as light. That was a real debate among the religious leaders of Jesus' day. So in answer to that question, Jesus answers immediately, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. And that is the first and greatest commandment." And then he adds a bonus, if you like. "The second is, like it, you shall love your neighbour as yourself. And on these two commandments hinge all the laws and the prophets," he says. Now these phrases, the words that Jesus chooses, are actually taken directly from Deuteronomy chapter 6. Now some look at this and say that's just one way of saying you're to love the Lord wholeheartedly with all your being. And I think that's definitely true. I think the point here is that you're to love God with everything within you, which is actually a reference to your mind, your emotion, and your will. In other words, your actions also. So then he actually adds the second statement, and he says there's also a requirement that you should love your neighbour as yourself. It is assumed then that if you have concern about your own well-being, then based on that you should have compassion and love for other people. In other words, their concerns, other people's concerns, should be as dear to you as your own. By the way, later on, just before Jesus is about to die, he tells his disciples that they are to love one another as I have loved you. And then Jesus says that on these commandments, all the law and the prophets hinge. Paul also said this sort of thing in several places, teaching about when you love, you fulfill the whole law of God. Meaning if you love, you will automatically do what the commandments say. You know, for example, if you love someone, you're not going to steal on them, are you? You're not going to cheat on them with their wives, are you? That's because you love them and you want what's best for them. So you wouldn't take your property and you wouldn't do these other things. And what he's saying is that principle applies across all the other commandments as well, that if you love someone, you actually fulfill the commandments. So now we've reached the point where Jesus has answered these three different groups of people: the Herodians, the Sadducees, and the scribes. So we're now in the final section, and Jesus now questions them, and he asks them this strange question: how can David call his descendant Lord? Let's pick up the text where we left off, where it says, "While the Pharisees were gathering together, Jesus asked them, saying, 'What do you think about the Christ? Whose son is he?' And they said to him, 'The son of David.' He then said to them, 'How then does David, in the Spirit, call him Lord? Saying,'" and he quotes, "'The Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand till I make your enemies a footstool.' If David then calls him Lord, how is he his son?" And no one was there able to answer him a word, nor from that day on did anyone dare question him about anything any more. So in this final section, Jesus turns around and asks them a question, and his question is simply a quote from Psalm 110, verse 1. Now, it gets a little tricky to try and unpack this, so let me see if I can explain it to you as clearly as I can. Psalm 110, which Jesus quotes here, the reference to "the Lord said to my Lord, sit on my right hand till my enemies make you a footstool," is talking about the Messiah. Everybody agrees about that. The rabbis taught that in that day, and they still teach it to this day. So you see, in this and some other psalms, we see David talking about the Messiah and referring to him as Lord. But what father calls his son Lord, Jesus says. So what he's saying, surely this implies that there'd be much more going on than just a son-father relationship. In other words, the son of David being called Lord by David indicates in some sense he must be superior to him, or otherwise why would he be calling him Lord? In other words, that the Messiah, the son of David, has in fact authority over David, so he's not just being a son under David, and that's the point. So then, whose son is he? Who is he if David called him and referred to him as Lord? whose son is he really? So humanly speaking, in his generational family line, he is of course the son of David, and we know that from the generations and the family trees revealed in the Bible. But spiritually speaking, it says that he is the divine Son of God. And friends, the scripture is consistent in teaching that very thing right across its whole canon. So Jesus here has put the question to them now. He's turned the tables on them and he's basically saying, do you even recognize that I am the Son of God? And that's really what's going on here. And their response is very simple. We see it clearly. It says they were unable to answer. Not one of them could think of a thing to say. No one dared question him anymore because they had no answer to that. Notice there is a definite progression in this passage. We're told after his answer to the first question, their response was to marvel. We're told their reaction to the answer to the second question was to be astonished. And finally here, we're told that they're literally struck silent, struck dumb, and they don't dare ask him a question in response. Jesus put it back on them by using the scriptures, driving them to recognize that he was nothing less than God's incarnate Son. That's who he was claiming to be, the Son of Man, the Son of God, and that they had to respond to that one way or another, to accept it or to reject it. Now, I know we've sprinted through this huge passage today, and we've looked at these four questions, the questions of the Herodians, the political party, who wanted to know about taxes, obviously, the questions of the Sadducees, who were the governing party, who had a particular theological point of view, and they wanted to know about the resurrection, and finally, these scribes and lawyers, who wanted to know about the law, and try and use that to trip them up. And the sum of all this is that Jesus answers all these questions, and in the process, he proves who he was. So let me conclude by making two rather straightforward points. One is to say that here we see our answer is required to the most important question that anyone can ask. The answer to the question, who is Jesus? The greatest question you and I have to face in life is that very same question, who is Jesus? But it seems to me also, as a bonus if you like, this passage not only asks the greatest question, who Jesus is, but it also indicates for the greatest answer to that other question of how we should live our lives. When Jesus was asked about this, he specifically answered and said it is to love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and to love your neighbour as yourself. Now when we love the Lord, we are or should be devoted to him, to the point that his words become our words, his thoughts become our thoughts, and our feet begin to walk the path that he lays out before us. And also, it's just common sense. When you think about it, when you love somebody, when you really love somebody, you talk to them, don't you? And you think about them all the time, and we involve them in everything we do. In other words, when we love someone, we share our lives with them. I think that's what it really means to love the Lord. And it's not that different from a good marriage. It's about making the decision to share your life with God. Maybe that's what it means when the Bible says pray without ceasing. It means that you're just constantly thinking, communicating, talking, sharing your life with him and responding to his prompting by doing what he tells you to do. And I hope that's the way that each and every one of you are choosing to live your life today and every day.